Morning everybody. Let's start with today's tutorial. It is about combinational circuit design. Today we'll take some real life examples and see how to go about designing combinational circuits. So the first problem is a committee of three individuals decide issues for an organization. Each individual votes yes or no for each proposal that arises. A proposal is passed if it receives at least two yes votes. Design a circuit that determines whether a proposal passes. Okay, have we encountered some similar circuit till now in class or theory or lab or anywhere?
3-bit majority.
Yeah, it's an 3-bit majority circuit. Okay, so this is the 3-bit majority. So the approach for any problem would be to first list out the truth table. Okay, so we made a truth table. There are three individuals X, Y, Z. So we have taken it as three different variables. And for the proposal to pass, at least two has to be there. So first we make a truth table for any problem. This is how the approach would be. Then we make the K-map. Okay, once we make the K-map, we know we have already done this. It is AB or AC, BC and AC. Okay, that's the combination. Okay, so here only some changes which is shown in this circuit is like in a real life situation we are going to place switches out here, right? So when one of the individual presses, the switch would be such that when he presses, you will give an VDD there, and when he releases the switch, when he's not pressing it, it should be ground. Okay, so we cannot use a normal switch what we have in our houses for fan and lights, right? Those switches are only single pole. Double throw single pole, so that if you switch it off, it will be hanging. So those kind of switches we cannot use it here, right? Because when it switches off, you have to positively give a ground, otherwise these gates will malfunction. So you cannot have these gates in hanging. So you need to, whenever you design a practical circuit, you have to ensure that if it is not a one, it has to be zero. So it can never be in a hanging position. Okay, so you see this, when it's switching it off, it is grounded. So this is the additional thing you have to take care when you are designing a practical circuit. Here at the output also an LED has been put, but there is something which is missing in between. Okay, so why is that? I am stressing this has to be ground. Can anybody tell what happens if it is hanging? Anybody? What happens in a TTL gate if you leave it hanging? Anybody? Have we seen a TTL gate circuit inside? Okay, towards the end of the course we will learn that if you leave it hanging, a TTL gate will take it as one. Okay, even for CMOS based gates also, the gate capacitance will hold some charge. Say previously you have given it one and then you switch it off by leaving it hanging, those gates will have a tendency to accumulate whatever charge was accumulated. There will be no discharge path, so it will continue to read the, even if it is hanging, it will continue to read it as one. So it is important that we provide a ground path to any gates. Okay, is it understood? Am I still audible or have gone offline? What is it? Okay. So you can actually, it is better, you can switch on your mic and tell me. Okay. Now if you see, this is a gate and we have connected an LED out here. Okay. So can we put an LED in a TTL gate output? Anybody? Can we directly connect an LED? What is the output of a TTL gate? what voltage?
5 volt.
5 volt. And what is the LED? Generally, an LED is require. Yeah, it will be around 2 volt, okay, 1.6 to 2 volt. So if you try to drive an LED from a TTL grid, this will burn, okay. So you'll have to put an 200 ohms resistance in between. Okay, so remember always, whenever it's a TTL gate and you have to put an LED, so you will have to put a resistance, okay. So all these aspects, okay, of how to interconnect these things and all. So this you will not be able to understand, gain from your theoretical textbooks. Okay, so this aspect. So I'll introduce a Tinkercad in the hobby class. Most probably Saturday's class will be from 12 to 12:30, and 12:30 onwards, and we will take on this hobby class aspect. So that. If you in that we'll use a Tinkercad, in that all these problems, if you, because in Tinkercad you'll be able to place an breadboard, do actual place actual switches, place actual voltages, and if you give an extra voltage, the ICs would, you can see the ICs getting burnt, and the LEDs, and if you try to drive extra current from the IC, so all those problems, practical problems, you will be able to visualize there. Okay, so that Saturday we will take care of those aspects. So I'm just introducing to a real life situation circuit how this works. Okay, so the next problem is design a 2-volt magnitude comparator. Okay, yesterday we saw magnitude comparator in the class. I think Tuesday's class we had magnitude comparator. So this is purely based on K-map, okay, that we applied logic, okay, if one is greater than the other digit, how to build upon. This is purely based on K-map, okay. So this is just this is for the equal, this is for K-map for A greater than B, okay. So these are the situations, right, when A is 1 and B is 0, so A is greater than B. Similarly, when A is 2 and B is 0 or 1, so these two ones are there, and this is the third set of conditions where A is 2 and B is 0, 1 or 2. So you have all the ones, so you group them and then you make an equation like this, right? This is when A and B are equal, so you write an equation for from the K-maps point of view, and then you write an XOR gate. Okay, this is not an optimized solution. The optimized solution was done in the class. So this is just an approach, okay, where from K-map for a real circuit design we can do this. So this is a condition where A is less than B, okay, when A is 0, B is 1, 2, 3, or B is 1, B is 2 or 3, and when A is 2, B is 3. So you group all these things, you get an equations, and you make a gate out of this. So this is A bar, A0 A bar, B1 B bar. So and from these equations you take those corresponding terms, make an AND gate and then an OR gate. Okay, this is an XNOR gate. So this I was simplified here for equal to. So if you see, it can be simplified as XNOR. So this is how one 2-bit comparator would be, right? Okay. Now this was the third problem where you have an input, 4 input, and output you have to drive an 7 segment display. So you have A, B, C, D, E, F, G. Okay, so this is the standard configuration, like nomenclature, which is used for all the 7 segment display. A starts from here, B, C, D, E, F and G. So for various it can give from 0 to 9 and any values it can display. So for 0, what are the displays that should go high? They are all individual LEDs like this. So anybody for A, for 0, what are the, yeah, A, B, G, G will be left. Okay. Now tell me what will be the approach. In the approach, do we have to make one K-map or several K-maps, several output functions? what should be our approach? Anybody? Can switch on your mic and speak. What will be the approach here? These are the inputs. So how do we go about solving this? How to get these outputs? Can we do it with a single K-map, or we require K-map for each one of these outputs? We have to treat each of them as an individual function.
Individual,
yeah. So, so this is a standard chip which is available. Okay, so you have to consider four inputs. Okay, A0, A1, it is written A, B, C, D here, and then you have to consider it as an seven different outputs. Okay, there will be seven different, physically also there will be seven different lines which is going to this LCD. Each line will light up one of the LEDs. Okay, so all are seven different functions. So you'll have to generate all these seven different functions for various input combinations. Okay, and now you have to only cater till nine, and then take the rest of them as a don't care, because if you take don't care, it will, the expressions will become simplified. So beyond from 10 to 15. So for each of them you have to make a separate K map. So this for each of the variables, like this is for A, B, C, you make an separate K map and you try to optimize. So from this table, for 0, 0, 0, 0, all are 1, right? And except for G. Similarly, when you have 1, only 1 should light up. Okay, 1 is, if you see in this, it is written BC. That is BC, only BC for 1 for display, rest of all are 0. Similarly for 2, right, this is 2, for A, B, D, E and G. So if you see A, B, G, E and D, so 2 will be like this, right? So you have to make that truth table accordingly for all the display individual units, and then you have to, each of them you have to take as a separate function and optimize using the K maps. Okay, so for 10 to 15 we have put all this don't care condition so that your expression is simplified. So once this is simplified, then you can make a circuit out of this. Okay, so this layout you understand, right? You write A, B, C, D. So all the eight variable min terms are available here. Then you can pick up whatever function you want using AND gates, and then finally you will have an OR gate. Okay, is it clear till here? Anybody has got any doubt?
So what is the meaning of a decoder?
Seven segment and a decoder. It means you have an four inputs, and you have an you are decoding it to drive an seven segment display. There are several outputs available. Right, this is binary coded, and this is individual lines.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so we'll learn about decoders today in the theory class. Decoder means this is encoded into a binary form, right? These are the individual lines. So that is what the decoder means. Okay, so okay, when we make a practical circuit, okay, a real life circuit, so this is an IC which is available, 4511. Okay, it takes four inputs. Okay, it takes these four inputs, and then you have an common cathode display. Okay, common cathode display means you will have an LCD. So you will have to there will be one terminal ground, so you will have to provide the ground there, and then it will have terminals A, B, C, D, E, F, G. So from here you can connect each one of them directly like this, right? And then you give the inputs here. Okay, these are the input switches. Now it is this particular IC 4511 uses a 9 volt supply. So since it uses a 9 volt supply, the output also available here will be 9 volt. So for that reason, we got to use a resistance, for a TTL gate generally we use a 200 to 220 ohms resistance. For 9 volt supply, we use 390 to 750 ohm resistance. So because otherwise this would burn. So you have to put a larger resistance here. Okay, so we have put a larger resistance here. Okay, can anybody tell me what is the purpose of this resistance? These four. Anybody? No idea.
So that the IC doesn't get burned.
No. It's very critical, these resistances. See the kind of switches what we have used here, right? This is an again the kind of switches which we have in our home, right? Switch it on, it will go 5 volt, and if switch it off, it is hanging in air, right? So this is four series are all CMOS devices. Okay, CMOS devices means there's when you it has got a MOSFET as an input on a gate. You are applying supply to the gate. So you have started with CMOS in your MEC course, or just BJTs? Have you done MEC course?
No, it's in the next semester.
Okay, it is in the next semester. Yeah, yeah. What happened was, everybody decided those courses which has got a lab component, we pushed it to next semester, and I was the only one who insisted we'll have digital this semester and we'll have lab online, because it will become difficult for you next semester with so many labs, and then you have to have basic about digital design before you next semester you will have microprocessors also. So if microprocessors and digital go together, the concepts of digital are used in microprocessors. So if you have not learned full digital design, you will find it difficult to understand microprocessor at all. So the prerequisite for an microprocessor course was digital design. So I said, okay, let us just try how the lab works out in online also. So I took on that responsibility, and hopefully you are learning something in the lab also. So by the end of this semester, I'm sure you learn a lot about digital, although it was an online lab session, but still you will learn a lot. Okay, so what I was telling is, okay, these are all CMOS circuits. Okay, what happens is that whenever you apply a voltage, the gate of the CMOS gets charged to 9 volt. Okay, and then when you switch it off, the gate doesn't get discharged. Okay, whatever charge, it acts like a capacitor. Okay, so that voltage will be stored there, so it will continue to read it as 1. So you need to provide a ground path, so that is why this resistance is put here. Okay, so that now once you switch it off, whatever was the charge available on the gate will have a discharge path. Okay, so if you use a very small resistance, that charge whatever is accumulated, okay, will get discharged faster. Okay, if you use a very large resistance, then that gate will get, even if you have switched it off, it will take a few seconds for that gate to discharge. So if you want that gate to be the moment you open the switch, if you want that gate to be discharged fast, you will have to use a relatively low resistance. Okay, so here 1k resistance have been used. Can I use an 100 ohms resistance here instead of 1k, or say 1 ohm resistance? Anybody? Right, these things we should start thinking, because when we make an Srikala, tell me, why can't we use a 1k resistance? Yeah, 1 ohm resistance here. Resistance drain. The resistance will drain out the it is supposed to drain out the resistance when you are switching it off. So if I use a low resistance, it will not destroy the CMOS. That's not the case. But we power wastage will be there. How? In what condition?
So when the switch is on, then the current will flow from the resistor too.
Correct.
So that's why.
You know, so Dravansh, no, right? Yeah, you got it correct. So when you switch it on, you will find from the 9 volt through the switch, okay, there is a ground path available. So 9 volt will be applied across an 1 ohm resistance. If you put a 1 ohm here, so 9 amperes of current will go from here, right? So that is pure wastage of power. So these are the design constraints. Okay, so when you start designing a circuit, so you have to think in terms of power, in terms of delay, right? It is not that we pick up any resistance and put here. So whenever we make a digital circuit, or for that matter analog circuits, okay, so we have to decide the values of these resistances. Okay, so you have to first your attempt should be, okay, what happens if you put a great resistance, if you put a large resistance, okay, then it will be slow, it will charge slowly, it will discharge it slowly. What if you go to the other extreme and put a very low resistance, so it will discharge. So we should think in terms of power and delay, both aspect, when you are looking at designs. Okay, so digital design. Okay, so this example was for common cathode display. So this LED is for, you will have in the market, you will also have common anode 7-segment displays. Okay, common anode means this is provided with the power supply. VDD is supplied here. Like you have a 5 volt here, right? This 5 volt is supplied through switch. This transistor is used as a switch. Okay, so this is a microprocessor. So the microprocessor provides the on signal. Okay, the moment the microprocessor provides the on signal, this VDD is available here to all these. So you have a set of LCDs, so all of them will be powered on. Now you want the display, okay, corresponding display. So for that corresponding display, you have to provide an zero to these terminals. Okay, you have to provide a ground. So this is the IC where you have ABCD, and it will provide, like earlier this IC provided once. Okay, so this IC is going to provide zeros. Okay, so this only one IC is shown here for this one segment display. For these two, similar ICs will be required. Okay, similar IC. So only one connection is shown. So here you see 220 ohms has been used, because this IC, this is an 74 series. Okay, this is 45 series is CMOS based circuits. So 74 series is TTL gate circuits. Okay, these are a TTL which uses 5 volts. So you have 220 ohms resistances which is going to be connected here. So now this is how this system works. Okay, so this is a microprocessor. Whenever you want one of them to be displayed, so you give a signal to this IC, which is 74 series. So this is going to give me this IC is known as active low. Active low means wherever you are actually supposed to get one, you will get zero here. So you will get an inverted output out here. So accordingly, so this design also we can either make an this design and put an inverter, or instead of OR gate, you can put an NOR gate. So this IC will be implemented by putting a NOR gate in the end instead of an OR gate. Okay, is this aspect clear to all of you? Anybody hasn't got any doubt?
How does the transistor work?
This transistor?
Yeah.
This transistor has got, say, three terminals. Okay, this is kind of an input signal, control signal. If you give a one here, this will get switched on. Okay, you learn it in a MEC course actually. Okay, when you switch it on, it will get switched on, right? So this is a microprocessor. So the moment you want the displays to be activated from the microprocessor, you will get some signal here to the base of these transistors, and you will have 5 volt coming on to these LCDs. Is it okay?
So, but in each LED segment, there was one ground, right?
Here we don't require ground. Ground will be provided here. This is an active low. So this is known as common anode. Here the common ground was provided here, and we were giving power supply. Here it's exactly different. You are providing VDD, and ground you have to provide. If you provide a ground in A, the A will lighten up.
Okay.
Is it okay? Okay, so in fact, when we do, once I introduce you to Tinkercad, okay, you'll be able to do all these things. Okay, several things. You can take an LCD, real life circuits you can implement. So I suggest all of you join that class. Since there is no assessment, it's just for fun, right? So you just try to, you'll be able to simulate a lot of things in that. So that will give you more practical exposure. Okay, this is the last problem which I had put here in the tutorial, which is about production control line. So we are manufacturing some rods. Okay, so it is being moved on a conveyor belt. Okay, so while it is moving, you will detect the length of the rods. Okay, so if the length is within plus minus 5%, okay, if the error in the length which is fabricated is plus minus, we considered it is okay, so we got to push that thing into one basket. Okay, now there is one more arm, so there is one arm which pushes it. If it is within this 5% plus minus 5%, those rods are okay for the next stage. So you will keep that rocker arm will push that rods into, say, left or right. One basket is placed, it will keep going there. So there is a second arm. Okay, if it is too long, it will push it to one other side. So if it is too long, probably it will push it to one basket, and from that basket it will go back again to the lathe machine, where or to the where it can be cut into the size. So you can do one more iteration and get it to within plus minus 5%. Okay, and then if it is too short, that means if it is in a, then it is of no use. You cannot do any more iteration. So you are going to send those rods back to the furnace, where it is again melted, and again you have recycle the metal again. So these are the three conditions. So to sense, you will have a light source and a photo cell. Okay, so we need to design a combinational logic to activate the these arms. Okay, so we said there are two arms. One mechanical arm which is going to push it to one side if it is meeting the specifications, and the second arm which requires a signal so that when the rod, it pushes the rod to one basket, where if it is too long. Okay, and the two short will just remain on the belt. So how to go about designing this? Okay, so these are the conveyor belts. Okay, so this is only a single conveyor belt. It is shown three, so that you understand the three different conditions. But and there is only one conveyor belt, and the rod is moving from bottom to top. Okay, from bottom to top, longitudinally it is vertically it is moving the rod. So when the rod comes, it will first encounter the switch C. Okay, what is switch C? On either side of the conveyor belt, on one side, on the left hand side, you place an LED. On the right hand side, you place a LED detector. Okay, so it is generally, if the light is falling on the detector, it will give a signal to the microprocessor, and we'll assume it is when there is a light, it will assume when the detector is receiving a light, we'll assume the microprocessor will take it as zero. It's an inverted logic. Okay, so now the rod enters from the bottom, so it will block the light falling from here. So now C will become 1. Okay, then slowly the rod will come up, then B will become also will get blocked. B will also get blocked, and then the rod keeps coming here. When it reaches A, even the A also light gets blocked. Okay, so now there will be different conditions. Okay, so now if you see, if the rod is A and B, both are on and C is off, that means the rod is within specifications. Okay, A is on, B is on, right? But C is off. C is off means you can understand it's the inverted logic. That means the C, the light is passing through and through. For A and B, the light is not passing through and through. That means the rod is of a correct length. Okay, within the specifications, which is the case which is shown here. Now if all the three lights are getting blocked, A, B, C, that means it's too lengthy. So the rocker has to push it to one side, and if it is within specs, it has to push the second rocker arm has to push it to one side. Now if the rod is too short, like if A gets the light, you know, LED between this LED and this photo detector gets blocked, whereas these two it is clear, that means it's too short, right? So do you under now is there any doubt between what are the light conditions? Anybody, is it clear how it is being detected? Then
yes sir.
Okay, then we have this the first four conditions is when A is zero, okay, then we do nothing because the rod is traveling, it is not yet reached A, so we cannot take a decision until the rod reaches A. So for A is equal to zero, it is do nothing, or you can actually write don't care there, okay, so do nothing. So whenever the rod reaches A and B is zero and C is zero, then it is too short. That means the rod has reached A, so this is okay, B and C are zeros here, okay, through and through it is, there is light, so it is obviously too short, so it will just leave it, the conveyor belt, it will go into the conveyor belt and it will go to the furnace again back. So when A is zero, B is zero and C is one, don't care, okay, this is the condition, it's a don't care condition. Why? See, A is zero, it says C is 1 and B is 0. Okay, that cannot happen, right? So, if the rod is touching C also, then obviously B is also blocked. You can't have a situation where it is A and B and C is off. So, that condition is not applicable here at all. So, that is the reason we say it is don't care. Okay, and A is 1 and B is 1 and C is 0, it is in specs. So, this is the condition where it is touching A and B. And C, it's not touching C, so it is in specs. So we will say okay, this is, we'll use the second rocker arm to push it into the basket, which is in specs. And when A, B, C, all the three are high, it is too long. So the next sensor, it has to push it into the basket wherein you have the longer rods. Okay, so this is how in an industry by using LED, LCDs and you simplify the expression and you generate the signals for the various mechanical machines. Okay, is it clear? So this is also one example of how. So in this tutorial, I just tried to put few problems to understand. Okay. Now, what is common anode? Okay. Why do we call it as an? See, these are all diodes. Okay, LEDs is light emitting diodes. Okay, so a diode is, you might have studied in your 12th also, right? It will have a anode and it will have a cathode, right? Okay, cathode is the negative one and anode is the positive one. Okay, so here all the negatives are been. All the negative terminals of all the individual LEDs are interconnected and brought out as a single pin from the IC, okay, which is known as the common cathode. So you ground it, okay, and you have the positive of all individual diodes, you will bring it as individual pins out of the LED. So these are all, they are not common, each will be driven by an individual signal. Okay, so this IC, okay, will have 8 pins out. Okay, one is known as the common cathode. Is common cathode clear to all of you? Can you just respond? Okay. Now, similarly, this is known as common anode. That means all the positive terminals of all these diodes are interconnected and brought out as a single terminal outside. Within this, okay, all there are 7 of them, all the positive are interconnected and brought out as a single terminal outside, and all the negative terminals are brought out as an individual pins. So this also will have 8 pins, and in the and all the positive terminals have been brought out, and that pin is known as the common anode, okay, because it is all the positive terminals which we are bringing it out. Is it clear?